You do all that in the bedroom with the missus too. So that's a completely different story.
Absolutely. Hell, sometimes I don't even invite her.
Oh boy, that brings bar bending to a whole new level. Oof.
Welcome to the RX Power Hour, your home for news, information, and entertainment from the world of strength and power sports. And now your host, the man of the hour, the man with the power, Mike Johnston.
Dear Francis, I've got something for you. Merry Christmas.
A choo-choo train?
No, it's 5 pounds of veal.
But Daddy, I have Santa for a choo-choo.
Well, then go out and get a job and buy a choo-choo.
Ah, Earl, he's only 4 years old.
All day long, I listen to people give excuses why they can't work. My back hurts, my legs ache. I'm only 4.
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. You really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus. You're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch. You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel. You're a monster, Mr. Grinch. Your heart's an empty hole. Your brain is full of spiders. You've got garlic in your soul, Mr. Grinch. I wouldn't touch you with a 39 and a half foot pole. You're a vile one, Mr.
And welcome, welcome, welcome. Happy holidays. Ho, ho, ho to all the, boys and girls. And Happy New Year edition, the final edition of the RX Power Hour for 2014. Looking forward to a big, big 2015. And just going to sit here and wax eloquent to pontificate, if you will, about all of the events, all of the goings-ons of 2014. And this is not a task, honestly, that I'm up to on my own. Now, any of you that know me, we better have a chance to meet. I do have a penchant for talking. I am a chatty fellow. But I thought I would bring somebody in, somebody with a big voice, somebody that is the pontificator of pontificators, the seer of seer, the sayer of truths and falsehoods, as you'll find out later today. But a guy whose verbosity is legendary, please, my good friend, the evil genius himself, B.Chavez. Broderick, welcome to the program.
Mike, thank you very much for having me. I really look forward to my opportunity to do this. So can't be any better than a holiday edition. So thank you.
Exactly, exactly. Great tunes, holiday tunes, classics, some classic bits, of course, already in the can and ready for your entertainment. But
have you the bucket head queued up?
I got some bucket head queued up, some fish heads, you know, and I got to thank you. You know, thank you for a couple things. Let's start out the new year, the coming new year, in the spirit of giving around Christmas with paying some compliments. I got to say that, the RX Power Hour started out alone. I had a couple of sessions at the beginning with Brian, and then I was on my own. And I got to say that the show took a positive turn when you, Chavez, with your sayings and your bits and the intros and stuff really made a huge difference. But also the introduction to me of Buckethead, the guy in the KFC hat. You know, if you can rock and shred a guitar wearing a fried chicken hat, my hat's off to you.
Absolutely. You're really not even getting the full package. The Michael Myers mask, the prison jumpsuit, and the KFC bucket really sets a tone for what's about to begin.
Yeah, I think that says it all. That does say it all. So, you know, just jumping right in anywhere, honestly, with this year, you know, the first big thing for me, obviously, kind of a holdover from last year, was right around this time last year, I walked away from American Strongman Corporation. Brian was unceremoniously detached from RX Muscle, and I sort of found myself in a place where I was just happy to be out of really the strength sports limelight. You know, I've been doing it for such a long time, but then the opportunity came up to do this, and then the opportunity came up, you know, early on to get involved with Willie's new organization. We'll get more into that. But, you know, I took up this opportunity, you know, and the first thing I did, you know, at the beginning of last year was I went back to the Arnold and I did some announcing for, you know, for Danny Daig and the XPC. And so I kind of went to the Arnold for the first time, not as a member of the American Strongman team, if you will. And, you know, I had a good time doing it and, I got to see a lot of friends. You know, but that's how my 2014 kicked off. 2015, I'll be back at the Arnold and doing some more stuff with you and some of the people that have been contributors. But yeah, that's the strength beginning for me. But a lot of stuff happened in the strength world. Where do you dive in? You know, I don't know. How about Zydrunas Avickas? 2014's
been a giant year. I mean, and you know, it's kind of a pun of a word in the world of strength, but damn it, it's been just a giant year.
It's been a big year. So, Zydrunas Avickas, I mean, you could say he's reached the upper age of a strongman. He's in his mid
500 pound log press.
Right.
That's
hello.
All you got to say. Shut up, move on to the next thing.
Right. But he also.
Fuck off until somebody else does it. I don't want to talk anything else.
He won.
500 pound log, move to the next item.
Right. He won the Arnold. He won World's Strongest Man. And then to boot, he goes and bangs out a 500 pound log. Unbelievable,
yep.
You know, and you could argue that the lockout was crisp. It wasn't crisp, whatever. Unless you were right there standing in that judge's shoes, you can't tell. And I don't give a good goddamn. 500 pounds gets overhead and it reaches at arm's length. That's a good lift.
Come on. Every competitive powerlifting bench press since the 1980s has been criticized. Oh, the pause, the bar sank, the lockout to this thing, to that judge. To it. Well, you got the Johnson to square up to a 500 pound log.
Yeah,
you are the man.
Yeah, if you
no
can,
other man, you are the man.
If you can,
all the rest of us boys.
If you can, if you can clean a 500 pound log, as a matter of fact, you know, the now that we're talking about the log, I mean, jump all the way fast forward to something that's coming up in February. They're having the log lift championship. Well, you know, we made kind of a big deal of the deadlift championship. You know, they had the world championship this past year. You know, Benedict Magnussen goes out there, breaks his own world record. Brian Shaw had been injured. Eddie Hall had the tying weight in hand, but he drops it, loses it.
Eddie Hall is my 2014 sleeper strongman. He's the guy that set 2014 to just unleash on 2015. He's the guy I'm watching.
And he's got an intensity about him. And that's kind of the thing, you know, we're talking about this jump into this log press for next year. But, you know, Robert Oberst and Dimitar Savatinov, both solid pressers here in America. They both own a piece of the American record on the log. But their cleans were damn ugly. And they both jumped up to 505, and neither of them could clean 505. So I don't think Zydrunas' 500 is in question until Zydrunas decides that he's going to go over 505. You know,
well, it's not in question until someone questions it. When someone else can do, say, what about mine? then I'll pay attention. But
right.
When it's just one guy all alone, no matter how good or bad, he's one guy all alone.
Yeah, and no one's really even on the same page. And, you know, so I found it interesting that Oberst is calling out Eddie Hall, who's a big presser, but he's not there yet. Where's the Zydrunas?
Those guys are probably pretty contemporary to one another. I mean,
right.
That's a fair call out, but that's a far cry from putting your name at the top of the list.
That's right. So if you're going to call somebody out, call a top guy out or just be part of the pack, I say.
Right, right. Right. Yeah, it's, you know, hey, everybody wants to have a club. You know, if you know, if I'm going to call out everybody's the second best club, I could probably come out on top of that list.
Yeah, but, maybe at least once
or
twice.
Calling out the best? Ooh, different animal. Wow.
Yeah. Especially when the best is Zydrunas, who really has nothing to prove, but he'll be there in Donchester.
He's just, he is a strongman. He's a real, live, honest-to-God strongman. He will put his big pants on and compete with anyone, anywhere, anytime, and he's shown it over and over and over. Hell, he turned up to set that log record completely unannounced. Didn't even make any fanfare. Just showed up that, you know, maybe I'll just pick up that one over there.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely, definitely dominating. You know, dominating. And then, you know, kind of where to go next, who knows? But, you know, in America, Dimitar Savatinov, we were just talking about him, he won America's Strongest Man. And kind of tying back to what I was saying earlier, you know, sort of doing the RX Power Hour thing on my own, and other strength radio programs have popped up and people in the know. And I was listening, yawning, fighting back the yawns, to another program, and they were wondering.
You don't want to know what I had for lunch? I'll tell you.
Well, and what kind of beer you paired it with?
Damn it, don't drink the alcohol. But I had a nice coffee. It was a very nice Sumatran French press. So,
a French press. Wow. I didn't realize, Broderick, I mean, I didn't realize you were so continental. You're so fancy.
Are you kidding me? I have no less than 5 coffee-making devices. And each one pairs with a separate bean. It's I don't take this EvilGenius shit, you know, lightly. It's a real thing, man.
I really don't have much to say. I like coffee. I had some Folgers, but it's just like, I guess, drinking Miller Lite. There I am on the bottom end of the you know, of the culinary food chain again. But that's all right. I'm used to it. I don't mind being the bottom figure. I can live with that.
It's all checked out, brother. Make it up somewhere else.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. So, and it came into question. I had a question on the, one of the listener questions was how Dimitar Savatinov could be America's Strongest Man. And, and I heard the geniuses, kind of scratching their heads back and forth and wondering how people that aren't American can be part of NAS and then later earn their ASC Pro card. But that's just something that goes back. It's a long history with North American Strongman. If anybody remembers when ASC first got started, Jeff Dolan, who was a Canadian, was an American Strongman athlete. And then, of course, who's the young man from New Zealand, or beg your pardon, from Australia? Warwick Brandt, he's competed at America's Strongest Man. There's been a couple Canadians. Paul Valancourt, who's a lightweight pro, he actually got his lightweight pro card. He's Canadian at an ASC show. So he is a recognized ASC show or ASC pro. So the American Strongman Corporation and NAS has a long history of having athletes from other countries compete within the organization as long as they're part of the organization.
Fair, Canada is part of North America, but
well,
I do
true
see
enough.
Your point.
Yeah. And the question just came up, and, as far as Dimitar goes, Dimitar has really never competed in strongman anywhere else than in the United States. He's done some international shows, but his first strongman contest ever was in Florence in 2009 at a show that we put on down there. And that's when he started with NAS. And of course he won his pro card and, you know, the rest is history. But, it's interesting though, when he shows up at World's Strongest Man and on the Arnold stage, he carries the Bulgarian flag, but that's simply because that saves the promoter money from bringing in an international athlete, you know? So that's pretty.
Right. Well, and you know, and again, maybe I'm being childish on this. Maybe I'm not, you know, playing the game to the same level as everyone else is, but you know, I live in the world of the internet. I live in the world where everything's available to everyone all the time. This proprietary and, dare I say, you know, nationalistic attitude that this is American or that's Canadian or what, that's kind of behind me. You know, strongman is an international sport. It's, you know, my lineage somewhere far enough back is Armenian. Does that mean I would have to compete there to get my pro card? It's stupid.
Yeah.
Just, you know, you are or are not a strongman. It doesn't have to have a domestication attached to it.
Yeah.
in my opinion.
Yeah, and it's nothing new. It's just it's interesting that the people that should know don't know, but that's just because, you know, they're just babes in the woods.
Read your own bylaws, Jack.
Yeah, I know. But I digress.
Well, you know, that is one response. Just, you know, read the fine print.
Yeah, pretty much. You know, so back to the world of strength. Benedict Magnuson, and this was interesting. If I'm not mistaken, Benedict is in the lineup for the overhead press. Benedict has never been a huge overhead presser. He's not even he might have done some stuff that I'm not aware of recently, but that's not been his forte. But deadlifting is his forte.
Wow. Yeah, a bit.
And I'm excited. I'm hoping that they'll have another deadlift championship. But I just don't – I mean, Eddie Hall, though, boy. What is it – let me ask you this, because obviously we all saw the video. Eddie Hall dropped the thing, whatever. He pulled it. He was fired up. You know, he was wearing a suit, you know, whatever. What is it about Eddie Hall, the intensity, that really makes you, you know, jumping around, but makes you think that he's the sleeper? You know, what is it about that guy?
Well, a number of things. One, you know, even in my business, my EvilGenius Sports Performance, I have a lot of communication with people of the UK, strength athletes of the UK. It's just a kind of a hot spot for me. And the UK just has a crazy, crazy good strength culture.
So yeah.
Anybody I hear about from the UK, I think that guy's got a chance because he has just a crazy underground, just almost ruthless mentality that I just fucking love that.
Right. Yeah.
It's the way strength used to be in the U.S. before they just got diluted with douchebaggery.
Pussification.
The UK is just, it's fucking angry and strong and medicated and for real. So right away, that gives them credence in my book. Secondly, I don't want to sound like one of those little, you know, YouTube butterflies, but Jesus Christ, turn on his YouTube channel. He's picking shit up every day.
Right? Yeah.
He's doing it. You know, a lot of people are talking about it. He's not talking. He's you hear a lot of clanging and clattering because he's picking shit up, putting it back down. Like, and you know, if you've got the culture and infrastructure behind you, and you have the chops to just do your job, that's a dangerous combination.
You know, the one thing I like about Eddie Hall's videos, and I've watched a number of them, is he does finish. A lot of guys are putting up videos and they don't fucking finish. Are you kidding me? Why put up a video that you don't finish in? Hey, you know what? I'm doing some partials today. Here's a video of the partial. You know, good for me.
I've had some great ass attempts on the platform.
Yeah.
So that's not completely just on attempts, because I'm attempting some shit.
Well, yeah. I mean, if you're going to show a fail, show a fail. But don't show like a partial rep and then come out of there celebrating and be like, I'm the man. And you barely fucking locked out, or you frankly didn't lock out, you know?
Hey, I can pound stone deadlift with, actually, no, I can't. Never mind.
Wow. I'll tell you what. Speaking of the pound stone deadlift, there's been rumblings that he's making a comeback. He's not competed that I've heard of. He's promoting.
That would imply in my mind that there was something to come back from. Where was he? Who was he?
Well, he had a baby.
Okay.
And so in order to, you know, there are certain things that need to transpire in the male strength athlete in order to go from lift up heavy shit mode to make baby mode. So that would be my guess. You know what I mean? But indeed, he and his wife did have a child. So,
well, congratulations to them. I'm a proud father three times over, so I'm on board with that.
Yeah. So,
by far and away the hardest job I've ever taken.
Oh my gosh! Yes.
Fatherhood. So
I love that commercial where the guy's like, "Hey, Dave, I got to let you know I got to take the day off." And they show it's a baby in the crib going, what? What day off? Yeah, that's good shit.
Absolutely.
But,
let me throw something at you. Talking about the deadlift challenge, which was a huge, kind of footnote. And I thought it was one of the biggest things in strength. Just since we're doing a year end/New Year preview, what do you think was the biggest news item of 2014's Strength World? What do you think is the one news thing that's the thing we'll remember that year?
Wow. I guess it's not something that, for me, it has to be, the start of a new, strongman federation in America, because it's not such news in that it hasn't happened before with powerlifting. Every weekend, there's a new powerlifting federation in America. And people have tried to start different things. You had the guy that had that hybrid strongman slash, you know, whatever. And Lou Costa, he came out with his deal. So you had Lou with the USSC. And that's kind of, you know, for all the piss and vinegar at the beginning, it's kind of sputtered a little bit. But Willie Wessel's coming back and starting United States Strongman, and then really ending up with, you know, 26 state representatives, a bunch of new faces, a bunch of old guard, and contests on the board and website content, and really just at the very least forcing NAS to elevate its game.
Which is what the new organization thing should have done in powerlifting, and it didn't.================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================
you know, is this the prime opportunity for a reality show? Yes. I mean, let's just do the math, because, and we'll go, we're going to put this one on the Jerry Springer, on the Jerry Springer scale of we're going to get Jerry beads for this bad boy or not. So you got man buys strongman organization in 2002. He and his wife build said organization until 2012 or whatever. Couple divorces. Woman takes strongman organization. Woman's
this strong woman organization.
No, it's still a strongman organization, I guess. Enough. So she's running it. Her business partner 2 years later leaves their business, and then three, four months later joins her ex-husband to help him form a new strongman organization. Now, Marshall White said it best, because Marshall is, you know, he's the guy in the know that a disgruntled business partner and an ex-husband are certainly going to fail at an attempt to start a new strongman organization. Thanks for your support, Marshall. But that in and of itself, I mean, that's at the very least, you know, I don't know, Duck Dynasty, you know, under Trash Pickers America. I mean, it's got to compete with something like that. You know, strongman, you know, you could call the wives of strongman. I don't know. There's got to be some room in there on the internet or on the trash TV for that show.
I suspect you're right. I suspect you're absolutely right. But it also kind of illustrates to me, you know, because you and I took different paths through the strength world to get to where we are. And, you know, I was never nearly so proficient at strongman, though I did compete in strongman. And actually, I met Willie and his, at that point, not yet wife and now ex-wife, at a big NAS event in 2000 up in the Great Lakes.
Yeah.
And it was the Great Lakes Strongman Challenge. And I think it was literally one of the very first NAS events in 2000. And didn't they really solidify in 99?
Yeah, they actually, Bill Holland started it in like 1997. And it was just local to Texas. And then it started to spread out by 2000, getting into other states. Matter of fact, I was hanging out with Willie at his show up in St. Louis, the annual Hope for the Holidays,
yeah,
8, with Willie and Jill Mills. And Jill and Willie actually both competed at that event in 2000, at one of those events in Texas. And of course, Willie purchased North American Strongman in 2002. But yeah, by 2000, 1999, NAS started to branch out and kind of got to the East Coast, maybe the Midwest a little bit from Texas.
Well, what I was going to say there is, and then actually you made me think of another thing to say, is what I was originally going to say is, though, is the thing that's interesting is, you know, everyone's like, oh, you know, the multiple organizations ruin powerlifting and this and that. And, but in a sense of the term, this almost isn't a new organization in that it's not like powerlifting was a split because of a disdain for the rule book or a disdain for a drug test or something that said we have to break away for these reasons. It's a secession. It's a revolution.
Right.
Whereas this is not that. This is almost the same people with almost the same ideas and attitudes. It's just another. It's just more.
Yeah.
It's like Ford and Chevy. It's not where, you know, one guy left Ford and goes, oh, I'm going to make airplane cars that fly because your cars suck. You know, it's not that. It's
yeah.
We're going to make something like you have and give people a choice.
That's right. And that's all it is a you know, choice.
Yeah, and it's, you know, at least to my mind, and I'm not the connoisseur of strongman events, but I don't see a vast chasm in terms of the competitive landscape. I don't see a difference. It's not that differentiated.
No, it's very nuanced. You're absolutely correct. I think that it's a little bit more athlete friendly. I think it's a little bit less, while it's a little bit more, from my estimation, having been on both sides, it's a little bit more business sense savvy. I think it's a little bit more athlete friendly though. And I just think that over time, when your motivations are for the dollar, you lose sense of the reason that you would even, you know, do something like this because, you know, you've put on powerlifting meets and you know, you've been a part of these things for years. There's not a lot of money putting on events.
If you do everything right and you do better than break even, you're kicking ass.
Yeah, exactly. You know, so. But
What I was going to say, what you made me think of to say, it wasn't part of my original thought, is I did compete in that event up in the Great Lakes. And I was actually technically against Willie, although quite literally, I don't believe I was very competitive in that event. And he, of course, at that point, you know, I don't know if he had intentions, but there was certainly no rumor of him buying the organization or anything.
No.
But I knew who he was through powerlifting connection. So, you know, I had a natural rapport. And I was actually one of those guys that probably, you know, caused you to grind your teeth in that I was kind of bitching because it was a 2-day event. And it just so happens, the way it was laid out, all of the day one events, which would have qualified one for the second day finals, were mobility events. It was the truck pull and the farmer and different stuff. And I told Willie, I'm just decided really pissed off because I'm one of the strongest guys here. If this were day two, I'd be at the top of the pack, where with these day one events, I'm at the bottom of the pack.
Right.
And even then, he kind of raised an eyebrow and he says, you know, that's something we probably ought to think about that when we're structuring events. We ever hold one of these. And even then, he was thinking ahead to the, well, that's a good idea. Let me write that down kind of mindset. That struck me as very savvy and just generally a positive thing. Made me remember his name.
Well, and you know, that's an interesting thing. All the years that Willie and I have worked together and we've become friends and we continue to work together, he's a guy that will come up with an idea and throw it out there. And he's also a guy that will take an idea from anybody if it's a good one. And you know, it doesn't have to be the genius that's going to give him the idea, but he's also a guy that will listen to something and change. And I think that when you quit listening or quit seeking other voices, that's when you lose sight of things, you know. But by when you're doing that, though, Broderick, and you tell me if you agree with this, you can't surround yourself with yes men and novice and frankly hacks. You've got to surround yourself with people that have been in the trenches that understand the business. I mean, bringing in a Jill Mills, I mean, that's a stroke of genius, you know, having people around you on your staff that have promoted dozens and dozens and dozens of shows. John Albrecht, for one, in Indiana, he's the guy that wrote the Excel spreadsheet program that we currently use for keeping score. I mean, these people bringing, you know, it's just like your cabinet when you're the president. You know, if you bring in a bunch of, you know, if you bring in a bunch of, you know, dimwits, you're going to get dimwit advice.
Well, that's, I mean, you know, I don't want to ever make, you know, an interview with you about me, but, you know, even with the EvilGenius Sports Performance, I mean, I have a list of people that I can bounce ideas off that, you know, pharmaceutical companies are paying.
Right. Just, you know, like
you interviewed, you know, Dr. Nick Ceranis.
That's right.
He's a good friend of mine. How many times have I gotten him out of bed at 3 o'clock in the morning with what I thought was the greatest idea ever, and after a 20-minute conversation, just left with my tail between my legs? Damn it! Thought I had one, and then just back to the drawing board. And, you know, it's exactly what you say. It's the caliber. You know, anybody can look like a genius in a room full of idiots.
Right.
But can you look like a genius in a room full of geniuses?
That's
wow,
right.
That's a little different. That's tough.
Or at least hold your own. And
absolutely.
And, yeah, and know when to take the good advice. But yeah, so I think for me, kind of the whole long winded answer, I don't know that it made that much of an impact this year, although I think its impact was felt. I think the impact will be 5 years from now, and you'll look back at 14 and say, yeah, that's, you know, that's when this
guy,
yeah, that's when things really did change. So, you know, let me throw that back at you. For you, you know, a guy that I've, talked to on the phone about all the strength happenings and stuff. What's that banner moment for you? What is it that you think 14 will be remembered for?
Well, I have an answer for you, and it's probably not exactly the answer you're looking for. I don't have a single event. I don't want to say, oh, it was Benny Magnuson pulling 1,000 pounds, or it was
right,
the 500-pound log, or it was the results of the Arnold Classic, or the World's Strongest Man, or the whatever. What I think it is, in my mind, is it's the year where raw strength finally achieved the levels that it should have been all along. We had guys in the late 1970s, early 1980s, squatting 800 and almost 900 pounds raw. And it took until 2014 till we had that again. But
yeah,
God damn it, we have it again now. The secret now is just don't let it go. Don't fall back. Don't relapse into that delirious fog that the strength sports were in for 20 years. I think that this is that moment where we can actually now move forward into some new ground and really be what we could have been 20 years ago.
Yeah,
I think it's that almost that renaissance, that recapturing, and now, damn it, me and a few other people are going to hold on with white knuckles and not let it go away.
Well, and I think that that's interesting because, you know, a lot of different things, a lot of different organizations come and go, you know, kind of moving to the Midwest for me and up, actually not so much Columbus, Ohio, but moving up here into Indiana, where you start to see the UPA and the USPA and sort of Danny's.
The USPA is real big out there. Yeah.
Yeah. Danny's coalition with XPC and then Rich Lack sort of going off and, you know, very successfully creating his organization sort of, quietly,
RPS, yeah,
getting that going. But all of them, and I think I always do think this, though, Broderick, you got to follow the money. All of them,
absolutely,
for reasons, have kind of opened their arms to raw lifting. And then the CrossFit set, again, makes it, you know, while CrossFitters actually don't practice strength training, I know it doesn't make sense, but it makes it okay to consider yourself strong. But it gives people that want to pursue strength an avenue. And all of these federations are opening and embracing this raw, or the raw with knee wraps or knee sleeves or whatever the hell. They're embracing these folks. Number one, you can put 20, 30 raw lifters through an event at the same time you could probably put 10 equipped lifters.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's just dollars and cents and efficiency. There's no straps. There's no slaps. There's no – you get out there, you fucking push, you pull – you squat or you don't, and you walk off the platform. It's just that simple. Next weight, next height. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
You know, it's not, you know, 20 minutes of sniffing ammonia, getting slapped in the head, you know, growling, banging your head on the bar, finally getting under, descending for 20 minutes.
I do all of that and still don't use the equipment. So I mean, I don't like any of that stuff. But
you do all that in the bedroom with the missus too. So that's a completely different story.
Absolutely. Hell, sometimes I don't even invite her.
Oh boy, that brings bar bending to a whole new level. Oof.
Absolutely. Are you kidding? That's my whole deal. That's my whole purpose, is to take everything I do to a level that you didn't do. That's my whole purpose.
That's nice. That's like Chuck Vogelpohl's famous line. Chuck, how many reps are you going to do? Chuck, one more than you. Nice.
Well, it's funny you say that, because the answer in my little circle of training people is, well, all of them.
Yeah. Every rep there is.
That's how many I'm going to do.
That's right, all the reps. So you really do think,
you know, when we're done here, we're going to go over to the buffet. Do you know how many steaks I'm going to have?
All of them. So
yeah.
you the resurgence of the raw lifting. I did see,
well,
and it was
not. Let me commentate. I don't really mean the resurgence, because it's been, I mean, you know, my quote competitive career. You know, I lifted through, my first powerlifting event, I think maybe 86, but. I mean, I posted raw records, or actually they weren't really called records because there were no record books specifically for raw. But
sure.
For instance, I did some mid-sevens at 220 in the squat in about knee reps through the middle 90s. And I remember 2004, for instance, Captain Kirk did that 824 at 242.
Right.
So raw lifting is not necessarily newly resurging. It's just finally achieved where I think it should have been, you know, probably in the mid-90s.
Okay. Yeah,
you know,
no.
I think we finally lived up to our potential as a race.
Well, I went to an IPA meet, the first IPA meet in Columbus, Ohio, hosted by, by Shauna and Dave Hoff.
Okay.
And I saw one of the best squats that I've seen, the most exciting squats I've seen in a couple of years, Dan Bell. I mean, he hammered out a 900-pound squat, like, you know, and I'm standing on the other side of the monolift, you know, 3 feet from him, and it was just exciting, you know. He was excited. The crowd was excited. You could see and understand exactly what was happening. He had some spotters and loaders, but not 37. And it was, frankly, the house went crazy. I mean, you know, it's good to see a big lift, and I don't give a shit. 900 pounds is a big fucking lift. I don't care if you're wearing goddamn, you know, magic underpants like me, or you're, you know, out there in your birthday suit. You squat 900 pounds, you're a man, you know?
Oh, you know, and that's something I've been kind of somewhat misunderstood in my attitude toward gear lifting. I have the highest respect for any person, period, that takes the time and effort to get on the platform, whether they're squatting 100 pounds or 1,200 pounds. And I don't really care so much about the gear. Pretty much my big argument with people is we need some different verbiage, some different nomenclature, because when I go out at 220 and squat 765 at a belt knee reps, I personally feel that puts me in a different category than somebody that does 850 in a two-ply suit.
Right.
You know, but I mean, that's really just my own personal prejudice toward what I've done versus what they've done. But I mean, don't get me wrong. I don't denigrate any lift under any conditions. I would just like to see better language to define what someone did.
Well, I absolutely agree with that, because one of the things that I've found less of, and I'll still call it a resurgence, but with the resurgence of the raw lifting, I've found less bashing of geared lifting.
Absolutely.
Because
absolutely.
And it always seemed to me the guys that were bashing were mid-level. I could
bitter.
Lift as they, and they weren't very good. They were mid-level.
Yes,
and these guys that are banging out 900 pounds, you know, they don't give a shit if a guy puts on a suit and squats 1200. They don't feel, they don't feel slight or biased, because chasing that 1,000 raw, and it's been done now a couple of times.
Amazing.
And every, here's the thing. 1,000's not going to turn into 1,100 overnight. Not raw.
No.
It's going to be a creep. It's going to be a pound at a time. And it's going to be interesting to watch. It's interesting to 1017. You know what? I'm going to beat your 1017 with 1020. Break out the chip. I'm going to chip you.
does anybody, I don't mean to interrupt you. Well, I do mean to interrupt you, but does anybody remember the Hawaiian record breakers every year
there
when Dr. Fred Hatfield would show up and go from 10:05 to 10:12 to 10:17 to have the fucking sack to go, give me 10:50. Yeah, it planted him on his ass, but oh my God, when you opened that powerlifting USA, you went crazy.
Yeah. Yeah,
it was, and you were going crazy over 5 pounds.
Right.
You were going crazy over 2 kilograms.
Yeah.
That was crazy. You know, now it's not crazy if I say, oh, he hit 1,400 pounds.
Right.
Yeah, shut up.
Yeah. No, I agree. It's not, you know, I don't know all the players. I mean, obviously you have the Lily Bridges, sort of that camp.
Sure.
I think you got out west there, Mark Bell.
That's the Lily Bridge camp is the remnants or the new incarnation of the Ernie France camp.
Right,
is it
that's
not?
Right. Yes, absolutely.
Right, okay.
Absolutely, yep.
By the way, no one mentions, let me just stop everything since I have the floor.
Please.
And just say, Ernie France is the man. I mean, everything is, and anybody who wants to take the time to look up anybody, you know, yeah, there's a lot of names. There's Bill Cadwell, there's Louis Simmons, there's all these things. Take the moment and look up Ernie France.
Yeah.
That man's the real deal.
Yeah.
He did the lifting. He held his ground in a legal battle. He had an equipment company. He's the real deal. You know what? Ernie France, I know you're still alive, but if you're out there and you hear this, let me just say something I don't think anybody else is taking the time to say. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for making the sport that I love. Thank you.
Yeah. So- celebrated his 80th birthday this year, 2014.
Oh my God. Just a couple another, years ago, squatted triple body weight.
Yeah, another milestone.
Forget about it.
And that is
that is
somebody, by the way, if you're listening, if you care to listen, if you've already turned us off, it hasn't been because we're boring. But I've been trying to get Ernie. I still want to get up there. I'm probably just going to end up driving out there and probably trying to do an interview with him in person. But that is somebody that I want to talk to. You know, Willie Wessels tells a fantastic story about meeting Ernie France back at a junior nationals back in the day. And Willie squatted something. And Ernie said, you know, what kind of gear are you using? He told him what it was. He goes, well, you wear my gear, you're going to have 75 pounds more on your squat. Willie went out and got some Ernie France gear. And because he was an Ernie France guy, my first suit that I ever squatted 900 in was a old beat up, restitched, rehashed Ernie France canvas. I love that thing. So yeah, great.
It was the same
great.
For like 25 years. It was that same?
Oh yeah, like, yeah.
France
sure. For sure.
Yeah, it was the real deal
for sure. But yeah, you know, yeah, I like that the raw. It's interesting. Certainly, you know. Because if you think of strongman in its purest form, although while they talk about being gear free, they wear all kinds of sleeves and this, that, and the other thing.
Oh, absolutely. Straps.
You get out there and it's just, you know, for the most part, it's just raw. It's just, you know, it's just you and the weight or the time and the apparatus, and you got to figure out how to lift it. But, you know, when you put a big weight on your back and you squat down, you know, and those haunches, when you're at that bottom, all you got keeping you together is those better have had some good, strong hamstring work, you know, because when you're in the hole right there, that's what's making or breaking your day. So, yeah, it's a good feeling for sure.
I'll tell you something else, a side note, and really not, you know, you asked me what the big thing in strength was, and there's my answer. It's raw strength is finally where it should have been all along.
Okay.
And also it's acceptance, which I think is key to the whole thing.
Yeah,
people actually know what has happened.
Yeah, I'm a fan.
Cognizance, you know, is a big part of success.
Sure.
But something on a side note, something that I really like about raw lifting, and I think we're probably personally going to be on odds about this, is you'll notice, or at least I hope you notice, that most of the raw organizations don't use a monolith. And I also really, really like that.
Yeah.
I have never been a fan of the monolith. I never will be. I really sincerely and deeply believe that setting up the squat is literally, in my mind, it's the racking and re-racking, unracking and re-racking of the squat is 2/3 of the lift. It's 1/3 unrack, 1/3 squat, and 1/3 re-rack. And if you can't do any portion of that, to me, you can't squat.
Right.
I realize I'm taking a hard line on that, and I'm pissing off half the world, but I do, in fact, believe that.
Now, a lot
and I really appreciate that the raw people are doing it out of upright.
Well,
to me, that's the Little Radimir's quote, correct way.
Yeah, let's be fair about that, because a lot of these big numbers are being done out of monoliths.
Correct. Yeah, not all of them, but some, yes.
Yeah.
And I've been actually in this very situation, is you'll see, you know, one of my 765s actually was out of a monolith, but that's because that's what was there. It's
right.
Not
yeah.
That's, you know, what I wanted. And again, it doesn't count for anything in an official capacity, but every single training repetition I did was out of a rack.
That's right. And I have had people talk to me about, racking and unracking as part of an exercise, because they do talk about it being an important portion of the lift.
Absolutely.
You know, for whatever reason, I had the opportunity to not be around a monolift. And so I had to unrack some weight, and I unracked some pretty heavy weight. But when I was first doing it, 700 pounds, 730, 740, 750, I was having a hard time figuring it out, because it had been so long since I'd unracked and walked the weight out. Well, I just kind of, you know, one day said, you know, I wonder if I just went back to my yoke stance, because I've so I yoke stanced, the weight pops right up. I stepped into position. I was right there. So it just took a little bit of ingenuity, and I had to kick on a little bit of memory banks and say,
Michael Johnston, are you telling me that there's actually corollary between powerlifting and strongman?
It's a possibility.
You're into a realm of heresy. Are you sure you don't want to recant?
I have always been a firm believer that the strongest, the best strongmen have a background in strength training, powerlifting, Olympic lifting. I just think they have more muscle density. They have more to work with. They have more raw, and I don't mean raw, not geared, but just, we'll say, brute strength. They can overcome an obstacle.
They're strong first and athlete second.
Hang on 1 second. Hey, Chris? Oh, all right. All right, we're back.
I agree with you entirely, and the way I would word that, and I don't mean to steal your thing, but the way I would word that is, you know, once upon a time, strongman was about being strong first and athletic second.
Oh, yeah.
And I think it has, to some degree, gone the other way lately. They're very good athletes that also happen to be able to get kind of strong.
Right, yeah. And I think, you know, and a part of that, obviously, you know, again, I don't want to throw any more love to the CrossFit set, but bringing in the smaller athletes in strongman sort of ups that athletic capacity. But what you're finding is that some of these guys that are strong, that are at more athletic, you know, I just watched a young man at 220 pounds over the past weekend out there in St. Louis. He did a 325-pound axle press for a max. He did it once, but then he just brought it back down and he went ahead and pressed it again just for fun. I mean, so some of these guys that are athletic, that are younger, that are getting into strongman are now getting stronger too. You talk about some of the smaller guys. I still think that you take a big guy like Zadrunas, who is already strong, it's possibly
also an IPF, you know, world competitor.
That's
before
right.
His foray into strongman.
That's right. Who can be athletic and handle the athletic movements, but he's just so strong that, you know, you're not going to beat him when it comes down to just sort of raw strength. But like a guy like Brian Shaw, who comes the other way from it, and you think of
correct.
Brian Shaw, and you're saying, well, Brian Shaw is a big, strong guy. Well, Brian Shaw is an athlete. Brian Shaw played college basketball.
And yeah, considered for the NBA, yeah.
Yeah, and when Brian Shaw won his pro card, he was tall and skinny. He's not the monster Brian Shaw that you see today. He became strong, and he just uses his leverages, and he's just a giant, you know what I mean? So
I was just going to say that. He also, on top of all that, though, he just has really favorable, advantageous leverage. Even if he didn't have that 100 pounds of muscle, he would still have the ability to move very large loads.
That's right.
Because of leverages.
Yeah, and that's just like Hopthor Bearson. But you've seen Absolutely. Him stand around at 400 pounds with a six pack. I mean, that's just ridiculous.
He's not even fully done building yet.
No, he's a,
he could be easily another 25 kilograms bigger.
Oh, yeah.
As bizarre as that is to say.
Yeah.
You know, he could be a 440 pound athlete.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Which is just unheard of. But it's one of the things I say in my, you know, my Evil Genius stuff. I do videos and something I say over and over, and it's not cliche. I'm just excited to see this stuff.
Yeah.
And I want to see an 1100 pound raw squat. And
yeah.
I want to see a 440 pound athlete. I mean, my opportunity to do it is past, but damn it, I want to see it. I want to be part of it.
Yeah. I'm still a fan, and that's the key. I am a fan of this stuff. I want to see it happen. I want to see athletes get opportunities to go places and do stuff. You know, it doesn't bother me. I'm glad that there's a resurgence with the IPA. You know, I am a fan of Westside. I'm glad that Hoff is, and Shauna are doing stuff. They're getting information out there. They're bringing some of the seminars around the country. I know David and Shauna were up at Matt Mills' gym. Matt Mills, a guy up in Connecticut, a lightweight pro strongman. He puts out some videos, and he locks out, and he makes sure that he's got a good lock. He's got a great training facility. I would say maybe something that is a dark horse that I've kind of discovered maybe accidentally by doing the RX Power Hour Hardcore Gym of the Week each week, a dark horse for being an important moment, is there are more and more hardcore gyms that are truly being successful. And it's not hardcore to the extent of, oh, we'll just say Westside, where, you know, you come in, you lift, or you get the fuck out, whatever. But it's hardcore because they're offering people opportunities to really get strong, to be around strong people. And you can go in as a novice or a woman or a smaller guy and still get the coaching and, the tools and access to the equipment that you wouldn't have been able to get, let's say 10 years ago, let's say 5 years ago. Those places
Absolutely.
Just didn't exist.
You know what I blame that on, Mike? Honestly, and it's going to make both of us cringe to say out loud, but I blame that really on two things. Douchebag commercial gyms like Planet Fitness and the world of CrossFit.
Well,
probably my two least favorite things in the world, but they're so responsible for that very thing you said, is they pushed everyone of any substance into such a niche that they've actually forced them to band together and actually become something.
Yeah, this mom and pop idea is really, you know, I mean, they're just, yeah, because if you have to, I mean, you've got to be white collar. You've got to be white collar with a lot of money to go to some of these CrossFit gyms. I mean,
right.
I know that there's blue collar CrossFit gyms, and I know there's some very good CrossFit gyms. You know, Sean Shoemaker's place in Ohio, in Boardman, Ohio, but that's because he and his wife take an eclectic approach. He was a bodybuilder. She was into bodybuilding. They're both strength athletes. They both do promote and compete in strongman. They both are certified. They bring in a real Olympic lifting coach, not a CrossFit Olympic lifting coach, but an Olympic lifting coach. So they want to, and then they create WADs for the regular folks, but then they have some CrossFit athletes that do a separate thing. So they're not trying to, you know, they're not trying to take a limited knowledge base, train a unique and big group of people with one small base of knowledge and fit them in an even smaller hole, you know, and they're not obviously like the Planet Fitness is draconian. Now, I'm okay with a Planet Fitness because they're geared toward people in my line of work.
No,
physical.
The world needs fitness.
Right.
Absolutely. No. Yeah.
But they're pushing.
How can you turn your nose up at that? I mean,
right.
If my grandfather, I don't have any grandfathers at this point, but I mean, if someone's grandfather or uncle or secretary needs to move around and be fit and be able to touch their toes and get up steps without wheezing, absolutely. Send them there. They need that. They need that.
But I see your point. I agree. That's, they're kind of forcing people to band together and say, if we want this hardcore shit, you know, we got to get it done on our own.
Yeah, and to go one further and add in that CrossFit, I think the two things, and my wife actually pointed this out, is one of the wonders of CrossFit, besides the fact that they just wear spandex at the coffee bar, and I love that.
Oh, yeah.
But that's a separate thing. They've made it a lot less of a faux pas. They've made it much more culturally and socially acceptable to be strong.
Right.
Even though they themselves don't really do it, they've opened up that opportunity, and a few people that have the potential or the interest can then move from commercial gym to CrossFit gym, and then ultimately filter down to me.
Right.
And by the time they get to me, they're actually committed to the act of getting strong.
Right. Yeah.
And it's created this avenue, this pathway to a much different culture than there used to be.
Yeah, they've been bitten by the bug. There's no question.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, it's funny how sometimes the great evil can actually be the big benefit to you.
Yeah. Well, in the strength game, that's what it's been. But yeah. You know, so you know, talking about that and the mom and pop gyms and sort of that being the thing, you know, the growth of powerlifting in and of itself, as far as I know, there's a bunch of competing organizations and that kind of thing. You know, some shakeups and kind of some organizations sort of on the down, some organizations sort of growing, you know, kind of West Side flopping around. But Donnie Thompson, kind of an icon, a friend of mine, not doing the York Pro, West Side Pro Invitational anymore. You know,
right.
Sort of unceremoniously kind of, I mean, I guess sort
bumped,
of just.
Bumped yeah, out bumped. There, yeah.
Yeah, so not really sure what's happening with that, but do know that you know, the XPC is in full blast, and Rich Lack, he's doing a bunch of meets, and he's got his he's finally got a 503B or whatever, or a 501C, whatever you call it, with his dog organization raising money for the dogs.
Yeah.
But he's doing stuff with Danny Daig, Danny having lifters at the XPC. But then the very following weekend, and I find this interesting, Shauna and Dave are having a big IPA meet at the place at the Arnold, at the convention center, where they used to have the big WPO meets. So I think that a lot of these organizations that are sort of on the rebound are going to start jockeying and leveraging, you know, some of this cachet that they're building up with these raw lifters and hosting these big meets. You know, and you have a company like Rogue, who really, you know, they're just a startup, but they're just throwing money at stuff. You know what I mean? Just because they want their name on everything. You just wonder where those dollars are going to land.
You know, and you make a great point. And again, it's one of those things, like, I feel like the potential for 2015 is just so great. Because we have, like you said, we have companies like Rogue that are looking for a legitimate, keyword, legitimate outlet for their advertising money.
Right.
They're looking for, you know, a respectable, sustainable, you know, and it's something that, quite honestly, and I, you know, again, I'll piss a bunch of people off, but quite honestly, no one's been till now. You know, I 5 years ago, I went to an IPA powerlifting event to help a friend of mine. I would, at the time, have never considered, you know, going to such a thing. And let me tell you, I mean, again, piss off who you want, the squats were as high as fucking giraffe vagina. They were way up in the air.
Wow.
What the hell? And, you know, you're not going to get any advertising dollars. You're not going to get any clout nationally or internationally with that kind of garbage. You're just not.
Right.
You have big, fat, beer-bellied guys with fucking beanie caps on and Chuck Taylors bending their knees 4 inches and then running around high-fiving everybody, and that's not going to sell.
Well, it's got to sell. There's got to be some appeal.
At the end of the day, it's not even a matter of, oh, my ideal of powerlifting, or, you know, my way is the right way. It comes down to have a thing, it has to be funded.
Right.
There you are. It has to be funded.
Yeah.
You have to appeal to the people with the funding.
Yeah, that's right. And be able to show them what their ROI is. You know what I mean?
Correct.
They've got to know, I'm putting in $5,000. What am I getting for my $5,000? Well, I'm going to put your name on it.
Not only that, and you absolutely that, but you also have to have a solid and firm description of what the product is.
Well, that's, yeah. And, well, I mean, you know, and you got to think about it too. If someone's putting in their money, they want to touch people. They want to touch. It's an advertisement. They want to touch consumers. And so you've got to get them consumers. That means you've got to have fans in the building. And now when the fans are there watching the event, you've got to tell the fans about your sponsors.
Absolutely.
You've got to explain that please go to Rogue. And if you're in the market to buy something because Rogue is funding what we're doing, what we love. So let's show support to them. You've got to be able to give that information back and forth, but it's incumbent on the promoters. And I think a lot of times promoters do is they get the check and then they forget who gave it to them. You know, they're not savvy.
I can't agree with you more. I did a limited amount of promotion myself, but the one overriding thing we talked about, me and at the time my partner in that, is we talk about we want people to take the product home. We don't want them just have them for the 5 hours that the event is. We want them to take that home.
Yeah.
Talk about it.
Right.
Come back and look at the videos. Wear the shirt. You know, show people, tell people about it. We want them to take it home and spread it around.
That's right. That's right.
And somehow that's been lost, which is ridiculous in the age of social media when everything's about spreading it around.
Oh, my God. The bullshit. You have to fight through it.
Yeah, that's all they'll really spread is the douchebaggery and the smarmy garbage. But the actual bones, like who's paying our bills, who's actually showing up to do the lifting? No, we forget about that. Screw them.
Yeah, there's all kinds of good and frankly bad information all over the internet. Some interesting information that we started to pick up. I am still a huge fan of it. In 2014 was my good friend and his mania, his obsessive compulsive disorder. But now we have a name on it, and it's called deep water. So myself, Mikey J, and the evil genius B.Chavez. We'll be right back with more RX Power. Ender, I always do that. I'm so fast with that. RX Power Hour, end of the year, beginning of the new year, ho, 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 Merry Christmas special. And we'll talk more about John Anderson, Strongman coming out, and all the things that rung your bell in 2014. This is the RX Power Hour, and we will be right back.
Just doing it. It's good time. Iron Mag Labs is the leading supplement company offering the most hardcore pro anabolic supplements. Visit ironmaglabs.com and check out our top-selling products. Asta RX, Halo Extreme, Sinustain RX, E-Control RX, Decadrol Max, Ultramale RX. Iron Mag Labs makes supplements that actually work. No hype, no BS, just real results. There's a reason you keep hearing about Iron Mag Labs. Come see what you're missing. Visit Iron Mag Labs at ironmaglabs.com for the most hardcore bodybuilding supplements. Quest Bars from Quest Nutrition is Dave Palumbo's favorite protein bar. It's the only bar that's not simply a candy bar in disguise. There's no sugar or sugar alcohols, no soy, and zero trans fat. Quest Bars contain only the highest grade protein from whey and milk protein isolates. Quest Bars are also the lowest carb bar available, only 4 to 5 grams, and they all come from nuts. Quest Bars are also gluten-free. Quest Bars were specifically made for people who are serious about their physiques and who want the highest quality ingredients. Best of all, they taste great. Learn more about Quest Bars by visiting questproteinbar.com and try them out for yourself. Check out questproteinbar.com now.
This is John Anderson wishing you a Merry Christmas and a Happy Holiday. I want to remind you, you can have a great holiday while still maintaining your discipline and diet and training. Myself, I can't stand anything that breaks my routine. I'm not trying to say that all of you have to tell Santa Claus to fuck off like I do. I'm just saying, don't let the holidays be an excuse for you to fall off the wagon. You can enjoy the holidays with your friends and family, all the while maintaining the discipline that is necessary to reach your goals.
All right, and we are back. And how fitting it is that John Anderson would tell Santa Claus to fuck off. I guess unless Santa had like one of those big meat platters, like, what do you think about that? Our opening segment, you know, wouldn't you want 5 pounds of veal for Christmas? I bet you John Anderson would, but, you want to talk about a guy that really, he's been around. We've been friends for years and he's been an internet guy, for a while. He started a new training complex, wrote a book, and predicted in the book that he would win his pro card. So he really, you know, because we talked about it in private, he really put himself under the microscope to go out and win that pro card the way he did it. And he did it. He was a professional wrestler, professional strongman. John Anderson, banner year for him in 14.
Yeah, that's, you know, that's something that could jockey for, you know, position of the year, item of the year. I mean, how many guys are that multifaceted?
Right.
You know, and temperamental and disagreeable at the same time. I mean, really.
Well, yeah, you got to love that. And he's got, you know, he's got an opinion, you know, if folks, if you've had a chance to listen to the segments, you know, he was kind of soft and gentle as John gets, I guess, like a porcupine with his quills down, at the beginning. But now he's just like, look, stop being a pussy, get your fat ass off the couch and get the work done. And honestly, I think that people respond to that because, you know, every once in a while, and I've got another one of my good, bad ideas I got to tell you about. Every once in a while, you've got to go an extra step. You've got to go an extra edge with your training. You know, you've got to, you know, you got to take the, you know, your vagina britches off and you got to push yourself. And if you do one deep water workout, if you train like John, now look, that may not be your whole thing, you know, volume with heavy, moderate, heavy to super heavy weight or moderate to moderately heavy weight may not be for you. And yes, it will cause you to be sore for many days in a row. But if you want to challenge yourself, you got to try one of these things. You know, I mean, you know, and this guy's got some ideas and the proof is in the pudding. He looks like he looks. And you could say, well, he's a genetic freak, but that clearly isn't true because he's got little pictures of himself as a little fat kid next to the, you know, John Anderson you see.
I'd like to say two things on that. One, I'd like to interrupt you and say that that whole, everybody does that, and it really drives me crazy. You hear, you know, oh, they're talking about Ronnie Coleman. Well, you know, he's a freak. Most people can't train that way. Or, oh, you know, his metabolism's special. Most people can't eat that way or whatever. You know what? Fuck you. Why do you have to discount somebody's success as being special or exceptional rather than the effort was special or exceptional?
Yeah.
That fucking burns me up. I really, really despise that. And you see it all the time. And a lot of times, I'm being a little overzealous because a lot of times it's well-meant. It's not really meant as a slight to the person. But I take it that way. You know what? John Anderson looks the way he looks because he's a badass.
Yeah.
And he busts his nuggets over and over and over in ways and in actions that others won't take.
Right.
That's the bottom line. Well, yeah, he probably has good genetics. Yeah, he's obviously a mean, angry son of a bitch. But you know what? No one else is doing it, so shut up.
Yeah.
Just shut up.
And people are trying to steal his ideas now, too, you know. But, you know, this is a guy that – I've never seen him. I have seen him purposely put a carb to his lips years ago, back in 2006. And it was my fault because I had a Hardee's promotion. I had a Hardee's promotion and he had to eat three of the Hardee's thick burgers. That's when they first came out in 2006. He had to eat three of them an hour and he did it. And he threw them up out in the parking lot right in front of Hardee's. You know, John, he can't like go behind a car. He steps off the curb and Hardee's hits the deck and just bends over and starts barfing right in front of Hardee's. I was like, oh my God. I was like, John, yeah, that kind of hurt our advertising, but that's him. But yeah, he's intense 100% of the time. So because I'm not that bright, Chavez, I always ever have this good idea that, you know, I'm gonna do this training regimen and I'm gonna call John. He's gonna think it's really cool. So I'll squat 100 pounds or I'll squat 185 for 100 pounds or for 100 reps straight, without ever taking the bar off my back. And I get sore for like 4 days. Well, I'm going to go 315 for 50 and I get sore for 5 days. I think the last one wasn't quite as bad, but it was some variation thereof. Well, every time I do it, I'm miserable for 3 or 4 days. And now I found like a little army of kids and then my training partner, Dan, and they're all willing to do it too. So it can't be a completely bad idea, right? Jim Jones,
hey,
drink the Kool-Aid. Anybody?
Let me tell you something. How annoying is it to people, or how annoying is it to people like you and I, that no one knows the history? I mean, right around the corner here in my office, I have a bookshelf just top to bottom with bodybuilding books.
Right.
And quite honestly, the information's not that astounding. It's, you know, we all know how to lift weights.
Sure.
But, you know, there's nuggets. There's just nuggets.
Yeah.
Who hasn't read Education of a Bodybuilder, where Arnold talks about taking Franco and a couple of girls and a picnic lunch and a trunk full of weights out into the mountains and do overhead presses until they fall over?
It's fantastic. It's beautiful.
It's not only is it fantastic, but it's essentially the same thing.
Absolutely.
It's exactly what you're saying. Every once in a while, you intentionally want to do something
stupid.
So stupid that you never want to do it again.
And then you find a reason to do it again and make it harder than the
exactly.
last time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. You never want to do that again until you want to do it again.
Well, I've been doing this in my little private circle of hell, and I found a couple willing little people that they're willing to go with me.
Minions.
But
who doesn't want minions?
Everybody wants minions, like those little yellow guys.
Oh, yeah.
They're funny as hell.
Yeah.
So I might have had a couple of drinks and been intoxicated in public, but that's a completely different story. But I have a new plan, and it's part John Anderson, and it's part Misha, because Misha.
Okay.
Misha is a badass. Van Hatfield. Van Hatfield and I sat out in a hotel lobby with Misha, and he was telling a story, and it was in good broken English Russian, and it was just flowing out of him. And he's getting excited, telling me why the Russian lifters are so strong. And he takes an empty bottle of beer, and he smashes it on his own forehead. And Van Hatfield and I sat there, and we're like, "You're a badass, Misha." I don't even have a rebuttal, but wow, that was awesome. And then later on, Raymond's Bergmanis stitched his wound up and poured some Russian vodka on it to clean it. So it all turned out well. But Misha the other week, and I don't know when it was exactly, but the first time I saw it, he PR'd, or it wasn't a PR, but he did a heavy squat, a heavy bench, and a heavy deadlift back to back to back. And I want to say it was in the neighborhood of 600 kilograms or so raw, mind you, raw with knee wraps.
Right.
600 kilograms or so on the squat. Then he immediately went over and benched close to 500 pounds. And he immediately went over and not 600 kilograms, a bigger part, 300 kilograms, 600 and some odd pounds. Then he pulled 330, which is, you know, whatever that is.
720, something like that.
But that was in 30 seconds.
Yeah.
Right? So I started thinking, how can I make that really horrible? Because it looked horrible enough. So I started coming up with a plan. And I did the numbers. And so the plan is this loosely. And I'm going to share this for the first time. And I'm going to do a write-up of it. I've already, like I said, in a drunken stupor, invited a number of strongmen. And because they were drunk and stupid too, they're willingly participants. As a matter of fact, I've had people email me asking me to lay the plan out and the date. I've actually called John Anderson and set it up. John, I want to do this sort of homage to Deepwater. I've invited some people to do it. I laid out the program to see if it was befitting of something that he would find, you know, thoroughly horrible, or at least abhorrent. And it was. So what you're going to do is start at a certain weight on the squat, the bench, and the deadlift. And in Misha fashion, you're going to do a squat, a bench, and a deadlift. But here's the caveat. You're going to start with 10 squats, and then you'll move on to 10 benches, and then you'll move on to 10 deadlifts. Then when you go around to the next round, you'll add weight, say 20 pounds to the squat bar. For me, because my shoulders are so banged up, 5 pounds to the bench bar, and then 20 pounds to the deadlift bar, and you'll do 9 reps. And then you'll go 9 of each. Then you'll go back, add some weight, 8 reps, add some weight. So by the time you get to rep number 1, and so what I did was I took the weight that I thought I'd like to hit for a single on each of the 3 categories, and I just counted back. And I deconstructed it. So you'll end up doing, I think it's 55 reps. So your 55th rep would be that Misha-ish max rep for in 30 seconds. So that's
the pyramid of doom. Powerlifting pyramid of doom.
Yeah, it's not going to be pretty, but I've got at least 10 people that are excited to do that. You want to talk about minions, Chavez? I've got minions.
I'll tell you a little. It's similar, and it's completely off topic where I wanted to go, but I'll throw this out there because it's funny. Something we do is a lot different, but same theme, same attitude. Every so often, we like to do endurance-based strength testing.
Okay.
I'm a big believer in your strength at volume. And something we'll do is we have 3 flights. We have a 225 bar, a 315 bar, and a 405 bar. And the entire lifting club will show up. And, you know, you fall into your relative bars based on, you know, what category of strength, you know, beginner, intermediate, or advanced.
Sure.
And the gig is you get 5 minutes to do as many repetitions as you can. And you can do them in any fashion. You can do just balls out to failure and then just stand there, or you can do singles. But in 5 minutes, how many repetitions can you do with that preloaded bar?
Right.
And then we carry that number over to the next time and compete against that number.
Right. Yeah.
And we find that a lot of fun. That's a really big party. I mean, that's a lot of fun.
Well, you know, somebody said, well, that sounds kind of like a CrossFit thing. And I was like, no, wait a minute. You didn't listen, because at the end, you're doing a real max. You know, it might be a 95% max, but it's real weight. It's heavy weight.
Even
you know
if it's
mean?
Only an 80% max, it's still you're gonna culminated, projected target.
Yeah.
It's programmed.
Yeah, it's programmed. So,
and there's no jumping up and down or rope climbing or fucking backflips or handstands or any other dumb shit. It has nothing to do with strength.
Well, if I can get anybody to wear spandex, I'll do that as an homage to you.
Fair enough. Good enough.
Yeah. So there we go. Speaking of spandex and an homage, whether it's important in the strength world or just in the, you know, in the strength world and the public persona of what we do in strength, you had the football player that came out that was gay, and then we had a friend of mine, actually a great young man, heck of a writer, a college student, an athlete, Robert Kearney came out like as the first openly gay strongman. You know,
good interview. I heard that. That was a great interview you did.
But I mean, he was on TMZ and everything, and actually showed up on an end of the year 50 of famous or influential people or whatever that came out of the closet. So, you know, I mean, as far as the culminating moment in strength, I don't know, but a nugget for the 2014. What do you think?
Perhaps I'm overly liberal, but you know what? To me, that doesn't even make the radar. Your performance as an athlete, or and for that matter, even as a human being, has nothing to do with where you put your penis. It's just not relevant to me. I don't care. On a level, I'm proud of him, you know, and I'm excited that people are comfortable doing that. But on a relevant scale, it means nothing to me. I don't care.
There you go. You know, and I think I think that there was some discussion, and you know how these internet warriors are. There's some discussion on the boards. Nobody will actually come out and say it. There's some discussion on the boards where it doesn't matter. It's not relevant. You know, I think personally to him, if it matters to him and it makes him feel better and he can reduce his stress and his cortisol levels, you know, by any factor, and it's going to help his performance. And he was already a pretty kick-ass athlete. So if it makes him feel better, then God bless him. But yeah, it's pretty much, other than this end of the year 50 thing, it's off the radar, really. I mean, it was the biggest.
I feel that way. Precisely what you said. I feel that way about everything. Like, I don't care what you do. Unless you care what you do, then that's fine.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to bring up what you do because I don't care.
Right. And it doesn't diminish your ability to be a good training partner. You know, I guess in strong.
A good person, a good anything. It's a good nothing. Anything. It has nothing to do with anything.
You know, as long as you're not trying to bang kids or being some kind of a fucking weirdo. Yeah.
I hone that down to, as long as you don't break the law, as long as you're not doing something, you know, that is, you know, egregious to society, fine. Who cares?
That's right. All right. Well, there you have it.
Real quick, I want to cover this. I wanted to ask you back when we got sidetracked. We're talking about, you know, strongman, and your kind of pick for the year is, you know, new strongman organization, new avenue, new opportunities for athletes. Let me ask you something that I don't think anyone has asked you. Being that you were kind of, quote, you know, little rabbit ears, the number two in the number one biggest organization in strength, strongman, what, outside of the fact that, you know, everyone's free to do whatever they want, let me ask you, what benefit does a new organization have from your eyes as an administrator, and what do they need to do to really fix whatever might be wrong, if anything is?
Well, it's an interesting question. I'm going to put it down to the, you know, and not in the terms that you and I talked about, the new breed of whiny strength athlete, but the old guard and the new guard. I think that you might look at Willie Wessels and myself as being the old guard, but the old guard is still a good 20 years older than us. Guys like Terry Todd, Ode Haugen, they've been around for a long time. They've done good things for the sport. And I really do think that when NAS started and when the ASC NAS system started, it meant a lot because it got guys exposure that couldn't break through that old guard. But the truth of the matter is everybody and their mother knows how to get to World's Strongest Man now. You got to get overseas. You got to do a Giants live show. You can pay your own way there. You can, because Colin Bryce, he may pay for, number one, Colin pairs himself with promoters that already put on shows. He's a TV guy. He'll be the first one to tell you. I mean, he knows the ins and outs of a strongman show. Don't get me wrong. But he pairs with guys that are putting on shows, and they make them Giants live shows.
Well, as we spoke earlier, he knows where the money is. He knows what's doing what.
The promoters may or may not bring Americans over. But it used to be that you couldn't get overseas to compete at a show that would qualify you for Giants Live unless you knew somebody who knew somebody. It's not that way anymore. We're putting on the RX Power Hour presents the Europa Games qualifier to a Giants Live show. If 30 athletes come out and compete, 35 athletes come out and compete, we'll get three paid spots, to a Giants live show overseas. All guys have to do out is come out and compete. So right now, if you look at America, it would seem that the organization has a lockdown on who gets to go where. Since the announcement of that event, Ode Hogan, the aforementioned, has paid Dion Wessels a fee to have a competing strongman competition on the same weekend as the one in Florida for a quote-unquote, rabbit ears, ASC Pro card. Just a couple weekends ago, Jerry Pritchett, who made his way to World's Strongest Man and the Arnold without going through ASC, he's the only American that's done it since the inception of the company. There's a picture of him and Callie Morundi, who's been a longtime nemesis of Dion and ASC, with a cocktail napkin, and they're holding it up, smiling in it, and it says ASC Pro Card. The need for a system that turns you into a pro is antiquated. 10 years ago, it was 100% necessary because there was no way for guys to get there. Everybody knows how to get there now. The internet has told everybody where to go. Colin Bryce advertises it. Nick Best and Callie Morundi, Callie and Nick Best have put on shows for 5 years, I guess now, Sin City. I'm having a show. What I would say about the new organization is not that it's an organization, it's the content of the character. And what I mean by that is, I had a very frank conversation with Colin Bryce, and I said, Colin, I want to put on a show. I want my dream show, and that's where the top three guys go to World's Strongest Man automatically. And I want to put on that show, and I always have for 10 years I've talked about it. Everybody that knows me in strength sports knows that. So I want to put on a show to do that. Colin said, do a Giants Live qualifier first. I said, fine. I said, I want to sanction it through United States Strongman. You know, it's an insurance situation. It's not a big deal. Willie's on board with it. His request was no. I need it to be unsanctioned. No, anybody can go to it. I said, all right, that's fine, Colin. I said, but I'll honor the pro system. And he said, again, you're not hearing me. No. Everybody, it's got to be open to everybody. That was his caveat. Okay, this is something that I wanted to do. So Willie's my friend. I'm helping him with this organization, albeit as an administrator. And I hang up the phone with Colin. And I'm like, all right, let me call Willie. I call Willie and I say, look, dude, I know we've been talking about this. And I really want to do this, but here's the deal. If I want to do this, I have to do it this way. And Willie says to me, that's awesome. Let's get it done. It's for the growth of the sport. It's the content of the character. He put his own business aside. He put his own financial.
But he didn't. But I understand what you mean, but he didn't, because his business is the growth of strongman.
Exactly. It's not the
There's
company.
A difference.
It's not the company. And that, I think, is the difference. You know, the one thing I can say about this is it's a good time to do a mea culpa, because the mistakes that you made in the previous organization, you know, picking weights, deciding that guys would lose their pro cards if they didn't compete in a year, whatever other, calling it, naming it Strongman Fitness, whatever bad decisions were made, not, you know, involving enough people, you know, it's like a do-over, you know? And that's the cool part about what I'm doing with United States Strongman. I reach out to people that are involved and I say, write something. Tell me what you think. Let me hear your expertise. People know what I think. They know what I want.
Absolutely.
I want to hear from you. That's the premise of this show. You know, when Brian and I were on it, it was just me kind of being the funny guy and making comments and getting people riled up. And, you know, whatever Brian would want to bloviate about, we would bloviate about. And I didn't really give a shit one way or the other. But here, it's what do you think? What do you have to say? Who do you want as a guest? What are other people thinking? And the one way that I know that I've achieved that is embracing the raw thing. Because I never gave a shit about raw lifting, but I find it very intriguing. You know, the women's lifting, I could take it or leave it, but I've seen some incredible performances by, you know, the women. The masters divisions I'm finding interesting.
Absolutely.
Maybe because I'm getting older, but old guys still being able to hang and bang and do stuff. You know, so this show, you know, has been a vehicle kind of in that same vein. And it's interesting how it's all come sort of full circle, but like that. But I think that the contribution that it will make, if it makes one at all, will be that the sport does grow. Now, I'm not in control of what happens overseas. You know, there's still a lot of underhanded deals and shady things. And there are some people that, you know, go behind and do this. Like, and that's all well and good. But if you're good enough and I give you an opportunity and hand you a plane ticket and say, go over there and compete, at least you got a shot on the stage to show them what you got. So all comers, get your ass to that RX Power Hour you know, qualifier at the Giants Live at the Europa Games, May 2nd, 2015, and earn your shot, earn your spot, claim your ticket. You don't need a pro card. You don't need to be a pro. Chavez, I'll tell you right now, you can walk up that day, pay your entry fee, sign that waiver, and you can get out there and compete. If you think you got what it takes, if you're good enough, fucking show up and be the man. Just like, you know, I threw that out there, and we're going to repost that video and stuff from Colin, you know, kind of give people a bump that this thing is coming up. But if you think you got what it takes, show up and be the man. Claim your golden ticket.
Just like that promo video for the deadlift challenge. Yeah, he said straight away.
He said it.
Like, if you think you got 440 in you, put your pants on and show up.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And I think that's a solid place to leave this, Mike. I really think that's the overriding what I hope 2015 will be,
yeah.
What I think 2014 was trying to be, is stop holding out your hand and asking what you're going to give me and put on your fucking pants and go out and take something.
Yeah.
You know, make them ask for it back. Don't ask to get it.
That's right. You know, and if you're coming to Florida, if you're coming to Orlando, you know, don't ask your old lady's permission. You know, spend a couple hundred extra dollars, pack up the family, and bring them to Disney afterward. It's a one-day event. Usually these things are these two-day events, so you got to spend, you know, 3 days in the city, and you got to pay for hotels. You got to come down there. It's fat guy open, so you don't have to weigh in, you know. The fat guys rule, you know, so all you got to do is show up and compete on Saturday. So you can bring your family and hang out the rest of the weekend doing whatever you want. There's no excuse not to be there. Pull your panties up and get out there and compete. That's it. And if you know what? I don't have a suit that fits. My knee wraps are too long. They're too short. You know what? There's a fucking powerlifting organization out there that accepts your little panties, accepts your lack of panties, and doesn't care what kind of knee wraps you wear. Get out there and compete.
You know, I think that's what the take-home message for the entire year needs to be. Is, you know, stop whining about what you're not getting and go get it. Go find it. If it really doesn't exist to your liking, then make it. Just do something.
That's right.
You know,
and we're going to start out.
That's
where we're at. And we're going to start out 2015 by Mikey J posting another one of his, I don't know what kind of, it's a bad idea, but it's a really bad idea. It's a colossal bad idea. Oh, harebrained schemes. That's what I like. Another one of my harebrained schemes, and we'll post it up. And if you want to come get some and give a workout and send in your video of the Broderick, I think he coined the term the powerlifting temple of doom or descent into hell or whatever it is. I'll write out the program exactly. You videotape it, and if you puke in the bucket, make sure you keep that on the tape too, because we want to see it.
Absolutely.
All right.
Well, I think just collectively put on our big pants. Let's get on with it. Let's do some damage.
Let's do some damage. Yep. You've heard of warmongers. You've heard of whoremongers. I guess they even have fishmongers. But now you've got strength mongers. I am Mikey J with B.Chavez saying peace out. Happy 2015.
Can't wait for 2015. I'll see everybody next year.
This is the RX Power Hour, and we will be right back.
Black. Shiny. Silver bells, it's Christmas time in Miami, Fort Lauderdale, Palm Beach, FLA.
Is the leading supplement company offering the most hardcore pro anabolic supplements. Visit ironmaglabs.com and check out our top-selling products. Asta RX, Halo Extreme, Sinustain RX, E-Control RX, Decadrol Max, Ultramale RX. Iron Mag Labs makes supplements that actually work. No hype, no BS, just real results. There's a reason you keep hearing about Iron Mag Labs. Come see what you're missing. Visit Iron Mag Labs at ironmaglabs.com for the most hardcore bodybuilding supplements. Quest Bars from Quest Nutrition is Dave Palumbo's favorite protein bar. It's the only bar that's not simply a candy bar in disguise. There's no sugar or sugar alcohols, no soy, and zero trans fat. Quest Bars contain only the highest grade protein from whey and milk protein isolates. Quest Bars are also the lowest carb bar available, only 4 to 5 grams, and they all come from nuts. Quest Bars are also gluten-free. Quest Bars were specifically made for people who are serious about their physiques and who want the highest quality ingredients. Best of all, they taste great. Learn more about Quest Bars by visiting questproteinbar.com and try them out for yourself. Check out questproteinbar.com now.
We at the RX Power Hour are beholden to no one. If it's strength and power, we will cover it. This is John Anderson. You better put on a goddamn life jacket, because I'm going to take you out into some deep water. John Anderson with a little more deep water. 2014 is rapidly coming to an end, and it's that time once again. Yes, it is. It's time for some brutal goddamn honesty. So basically what you need to do is take yourself to the closest mirror you can find. Look yourself straight in the eye. Be honest with your answer when you ask yourself, did you get better this year? Did you reach your goals this year? Did you go to the gym every single time you were scheduled to? Did you stay on your nutrition the way that you intended to from the beginning of 2014? Did you do all the things you set out to do in this calendar year? Well, most of us, the answer is going to be a very simple no. Well, I'm here to tell you, right here, right now, 2015 is a clean, clear slate. Don't fuck it up again. For those of you that actually got your shit done, stayed tight, stayed true to everything you wanted, congratulations, because let me tell you, there's not many of you out there. And for those that did it, I applaud you. For those that did not and made all sorts of little fruity, faggoty excuses for why you couldn't do what you wanted to do, it's time to man up, goddammit. You cannot continue to make excuses for yourself for the rest of your life. That's what you'll become the best at. Not reaching your goals, you will become a professional excuse maker, and that is no way to live. It is time, right now, to ante up, look yourself in the eye, and realize you're bullshitting yourself. Put an end to this cycle. Don't let it happen again. 2015 is right around the corner, and it's a brand new start. So here's what I recommend. Set goals for yourself that are obtainable. Don't set goals that are so lofty that you're going to get disappointed when you don't make progress. Don't get me wrong, I love a huge goal. But maybe set a few that are a little closer, a few goals that are much more attainable to keep your momentum going. You have to remember, success is all about preparation. You're not going to wake up every day and just stumble across success. You plan success the night before it happens. Don't go to bed tonight until tomorrow is planned. That's your training. That's your diet. Hell, that's even your work. Prepare to succeed. Make 2015 your year. Make 2015 the year that changed your life. John Anderson, Deep Water.
All right. And as John Anderson says, don't become a professional excuse maker. Get your fat ass off the couch and get something done in 2015. Well, that's all the time we have from all of us here at the RX Power Hour. I want to thank all of you for listening to this holiday end of year special. It probably won't air until 2015, but so be it. This is the best of the rest of 2014. Make sure you tune in with us. You're going to hear lots more information on upcoming events with the RX Power Hour. It presents the Europa Games Giants Live qualifier and all the happenings in the world of powerlifting and strongman. Please do tune in, and please being part of the show. Please continue to be part of the show. Send in your questions, send in your comments, and we'll get them. We'll get to them. We'll answer them. We'll give you the feedback. And if you've got feedback for us, certainly email rxpowerhour@gmail.com. Want to thank all the peeps at RX Muscle for supporting the show. Want to thank Krista T for hanging in there with me. All my contributors, of course, Chavez, Mendelson, Anderson, the usual suspects. Want to thank my peeps, Little Michael, Sissy, and G. You guys are always with me. I am Mikey J, wishing you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. We'll be right back.
Yeah.